that you noticed went along with interactive read aloud? What did you think about?
Well, I guess this would be a place where you could have more complex texts because the teacher's providing a lot of support and reading the words for students, and if I'm understanding interactive read aloud correctly. Definitely we want it to be engaging so that they're listening, since it's the whole group of students there together. And I'm usually, as an EL teacher, I'm usually have a smaller group of students, but I'm trying to envision how this would work with 25, 30 students at once. So those are a couple words that jumped out.
Great thinking. So Ben, if you had filled out your stars, we'd ask you to come stick them on the wall. So I'm gonna stick them up there for you, just so you get the flow.
Thank you.
So Ben said engaging as well as complex. Did you notice or think that those two descriptors fit with any of the other components up there?
I think engaging fits with every single one, right? When you work, yeah.
So Kelly, again, like we would ask you then to come stick yours up and kind of fit that. Patrick?
I was thinking of complex, but also accessible, because I know back to my own days of reading, I wasn't a very good reading, but shared reading might be the kind of thing that would have helped me take on text that was at my grade level, even though I wasn't.
So I heard you say take on reading. Do you think that is only for shared reading, or does that fit in other places? Catherine, I see you nodding. You want to share?
Well, I think independent reading. Looking at the difference, the grade appropriate and age appropriate. You know, that's really, that's so interesting, right? That I think for sure, like, I was thinking about where would be age appropriate but not necessarily grade appropriate, and there are a couple places, but maybe one for sure in independent reading, right? But I could be a really gifted reader, but I need to make sure it's also, and I might be reading something that's beyond what would be grade appropriate, if that makes sense, but that still needs to be age appropriate, because that gets tricky really fast. And the opposite is also true, right? If I'm a struggling reader, I'm thinking about my second graders, I have a huge range, right? If I'm struggling, I still want something that's respectful and that's age appropriate for me, that, you know, but it may not be completely grade appropriate, right?
And Kelly, I'm so glad you said that, because when you think about interactive reading aloud, and Ben kind of, you know, spoke to this about the EL learners, that's where we can give those kiddos that might not be able to access it in independent reading exposure to the vocabulary and the comprehension and the rich text and the rich language that they're not going to be able to access independently. So that is a huge reason why we do interactive read aloud. And it's very interesting, because when you do interactive read aloud and you have those comprehension conversations, it's, you're blown away by those readers that are lower level readers, or sometimes our EL readers, that when you ask these above or beyond the text questions, they're the ones that can answer them. But that never would have been posed to them if they were just reading independently, because they couldn't have access to that.
So Kelly, I heard you really think age appropriate really fell with independent reading. Do you think it also fits in the other components?
Guided reading, for sure.
Absolutely, right? So grade appropriate, we were kind of thinking maybe not so much for independent, but the others. Does anybody want to share their thinking on that one? Patrick?
Say that again.
So as we listened to Kelly, Kelly was thinking more age appropriate, definitely, but if we have a higher reader, maybe they do need to be reading a higher grade level text or lower grade level text for independent reading.
I guess I was thinking, though, too, what I was saying about me being a poor reader. Like, I was always in the Blackbird group when I was in school, but if I had some of the shared reading, my teacher would have been letting me be exposed to what was at my grade level,
that's right.
But I couldn't handle on my own.
And what the soaring eagles
would be. Right. We call them the bluebirds.
Yeah. And that's a really important point, because in our classroom, we do have students who struggle. And so if they're only reading text at their reading level, we're never pulling them up to meet the standards of what they do need to accomplish. And so that part really is appropriate. The one that we did talk about was authentic. Ben?
Well, I was just going to bring up authentic because I know for my students, I don't know exactly what you mean by authentic in this case, but I think it's, we talk with EL teachers a lot about, you know, books as doors and windows, or mirrors and windows rather, books where you can see yourself in them and then also see the world through them. And a lot of times, books my kids are reading, they don't get to see themselves in the book. So I think something that's authentic to their experience is really important in all of those.
And I think being very purposeful in the books that we choose, and purposeful in how we're teaching our children to pick out books for their independent book baskets, that it can't just be something that we grab off the shelf. We have to be intentional and purposeful in why we're picking that. So as you look at all these descriptors, what are you noticing about where they fit? Are they specifically just for one component, or is it a common thread throughout all? So those are some of the big ideas when we think about text level. Yes, we know our guided reading has to be at that instructional level, but these descriptors also fit in as we as teachers are picking that textbook for them. But really making sure too that as we select those texts for our kids throughout the day, that we have all of these components in there. Okay. So as you notice, this is the framework. Oh wait, did we take that out?
Well, no,
sorry.
then we're going to go through having the writing. You're
so
good.
You would repeat that process, what you just did for reading, now with writing. You'd have a separate baggie with your pictures and headings. We're not going to make you do that today. But we would go through the same process down here. The only difference is we don't have descriptors for the stars, so really it's separate.
It's a little quicker.
A little faster. Mm-hmm. So then there's your steps again. Okay, so this is,
I just wondered, In that, if you, I know we talked in our little group over here as we matched those about the confusion between shared and interactive, and I was starting to, you know, step out of the role, but just anticipating, I think this is where it gets confusing again, because they flip-flop from interactive.
Yes. So really pulling that out in that conversation. That's really good feedback. Mm-hmm. Really good feedback. This is what you're thinking of.
The person that's like, oh, just starting to make sense to me when you're talking about it over there. I have it in my head that interactive is first, and now you've got it flipped down here. Not to belabor a point, but.
How can you clarify that?
So, shared writing, the teacher's the one controlling the pen or the pencil. The ideas are generated from the students, so they're the ones creating what the text will sound like. The teacher's the one doing all the writing for them. So, the kids are released from having to think about spelling, punctuation, anything in terms of the written piece. Interactive writing is where the students are still constructing that piece of writing with the teacher. Teachers help guiding that conversation, but they're strategically giving the student the pencil or the pen to help them come up and write. So it might be part of a word, it might be an entire word, it might be punctuation, but knowing what we know about our kids, it's either a way to help them practice the skill that they're working on or a way for us to see what do they know. So that's why it shifted. Here, the teacher is really the one doing the majority of the work. Kids are generating the thinking. This is the one where we're going to give the child an opportunity to show us what they know, but we're still going to hold a lot of that control. Yeah.
We're focusing on writing, and so since we're thinking writing, since the teacher is doing all the writing, that's the highest level of teacher support, right?
I signed up for a class called Getting Started with Reader's Workshop with Abby Miller.
She starts over there.
Is this all Reader's Workshop on top? What's that mean, Reader's Workshop? Where does that fit? Because I see Writer's Workshop.
So as a math teacher in Reader's Workshop.
My whole team made me sign up.
Okay, well that's great. So in Reader's Workshop, the interactive read aloud is actually separate. So that could be a part of the Reader's Workshop. It could also be separate. Shared reading is a tool. So shared reading doesn't happen every single day. You use it when it's needed. Reader's Workshop is really the guided reading, which is what the teacher's doing. While the teacher is doing the guided reading lessons, the rest of the students are doing independent reading. And what that looks like, depending on your grade level, does look differently. So you as a, what grade level are you?
Fourth.
As a fourth grade teacher, your students during independent reading time would be reading, and they'd be writing about their reading to show their thinking. So the last two components are what would happen during Reader's Workshop. Good question.
So then this is, we don't have our grounding article yet, and we're not sure exactly where this is gonna fit in, but we figure we have a summer to figure that piece out.
And we would like feedback if you thought it should go before this activity, we had decided after, just for a lot of reasons.
Mm-hmm. We did, we also, we showed Shelley kind of some of our work, and one thing that she said is if you find your article, because we were like, do we have them read it before they come? No, nobody will. Do we send it with them? And she said, maybe have the article there, and as facilitators, you refer to that article, and then it is something that's in their packet that they would take with them, and maybe we refer back to that in our next staff meeting that we're gonna have when we start with.
I'll just comment that I think having the activities first is smart, because you're letting them build some schema, and then you'll give them the article.
Okay.
I would say, I would suggest when you find the article, use a snippet of it, like they could read a paragraph or two, which helps us model that we, like we've tried to do in APD, that we always put informational text into everything we do. But then it could be the impetus to say, now read the rest of it for your next meeting. I think you could break it into those pieces.
And we really, Patrick, what you said is why we did it the way we did it, because working with Shelley, going on that constructivist mentality that they did need to be engaged in some activity before they needed to go back. And then start to have something to hook onto.
And you might, what you probably will plan on doing is, because you know, we'll have some of those folks that are still sitting, I think, yeah, I'm hearing a lot about this for the second year in a row, I don't know how it goes with mine. So you might be able to reinforce, A, we're not asking you all to do all these things, but when we are all on the same page, we support one another.
Okay. So at this point, we would ask participants to use a reflection sheet, jot down any notes you have, any questions you're thinking about. Go ahead, take a quick break, and then we're going to come back and continue.
Is
there
a Google
slide? This?
Yes.
Yes.
But we're going to finish it. Please do.
Can I just say that mirrors and windows thing was just
poetic.
It was my language.
Yeah. I wrote it down.
It's a great article about it, though.
I would
use that
article.
That painted a picture.
Find a wood article about it and share it with us, but that would be really good.
Books is mirrors and windows.
I have a neighbor that called, and they're having a work test. They're having a graduation party on June 3rd, and they wonder if it's okay to have some of their guests just park in the school lot. I said I thought it was They think that if people park in the school lot,
so where was that?
They can walk to their backyard, but they have to cross the playground. I said,
Okay. Here we go. So you had your break. Are you ready to go? Do you need another cinnamon roll?
On your way back, grab a cinnamon roll.
Okay. All right, we're going to actually move back here for an interactive read aloud, and we're going to sit in a circle. Chairs that are your walking.
No, so you don't need anything at all, other than you're very smart.
All you need are your brains.
And you can grab a treat.
Jenny, did you have a cinnamon stick yet?
So was it delicious? I already sparkled my own.
You don't have a second.
Right.
So Patrick can feel better.
Because then if you have two.